Welcome to Father Matt's Bible Studies and Sermons podcast. My name is Matthew Mead. I'm the priest and rector at the Parish of Christ the Redeemer in Pelham, New York. In today's Bible study, we continue reading the Gospel according to St. John, finishing chapter 8 and reading all of chapter 9. God bless and hope you enjoy the Bible study.
All right, after a little bit of hijinks, let us pray. Almighty God, we ask your blessing on our Bible study and our technology, that it may soon be restarted and connected. All this we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, so we're on John 8, chapter 8, verse 31. I don't have quite the same breakdown as we did before. JD, can you read 31 to 38, and we'll talk about that a little bit.
Okay. Then Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying we will be free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The Son has a place there forever. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are descendants of Abraham, yet you look for an opportunity to kill me, because there is no place in you for my word. I declare that I have seen in the Father's presence. As for you, you should do what you have heard from the Father."
Great. Okay. The major issue here, I think, is around Abraham and slavery. And I think the connection probably is back to Exodus again, which we've been dealing with. And it is, once again, that God is the one that has made the people free with the Exodus. And so they're getting upset with Jesus saying that he is the one that's going to make them free. They have not been slaves since the time of Egypt. I think there's a jarringness to him saying that they're slaves now and they need to be free from what they are. The link to Abraham, I think, is that probably related to a Christian Jewish conversation that was going on, in addition to what Jesus is saying, which is a lot of what goes on in St. Paul. Keep in mind some of the timeline on this. We talked about this a little bit last time, where there's the real time in the gospel narrative, and then there's the conversations, you know, 50 years later or whatever it is, with the communities of the evangelists and the synagogues and the writer's perspective. And in between that time period is when all of St. Paul's letters get written. And a lot of what Paul does is links faith to Abraham, and belief rather than practice is what matters. And so I do think some of that is going on here as well. Any comments or questions on this? One more thing, that the whole descendants of Abraham thing is linked to that. One of the things that Paul talks about is that we're all part of, you know, anybody that believes is part of Abraham, as opposed to following the exact birth line from Abraham down through Moses and into the people. It's beyond being simply a group of people that are by birth part of this or observe this by practice. It's simply belief. That's my thoughts, at least. Any comments on that or questions? Okay. Who else is here? Etta, do you have a Bible? Okay. Can you read 39 to 47?
Okay. They answered him, "Abraham is our father." Jesus said to them, "If you were Abraham's children, you would be doing what Abraham did. But now you're trying to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. This is not what Abraham did." Where am I supposed to go to?
Through verse 47.
Okay. You are indeed doing what your father does, they said to him. We are not illegitimate children. We have one father, God himself. Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I came from God and now I am here. I did not come on my own, but he sent me. Why do you not understand what I say? It is because you cannot accept my word. You are from your father, the devil, and you chose to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks according to his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies. But because I tell you, because I tell the truth, you do not believe me. Which of you convicts me of sin? If I tell the truth, why do you not believe me? Whoever is from God hears the word of God. The reason you do not hear them is that you are not from God.
Okay, great. So this continues what was going on, but it gets a little harsher. There's two not very nice things said. First is one about Jesus, which is, and this is one of the few kind of references. There's a couple in John. Joseph is not on the scene. Mary is not mentioned by name. And this is one of those scenes where they talk about, they said to him, we are not illegitimate children. We have one father, God himself. And that, I think, is often read as a really kind of snide or nasty remark about the tradition around Jesus's birth, which we know, you know, the birth narratives from Matthew and Luke, but it seems fairly clear that one of the knocks on Jesus related to that is, oh, he's illegitimate or something. And you can, if you know the, the birth stories, you can see how one would infer that, to for lack of a better way to put that. The other one is, again, it gets linked. I think this gets linked where Abraham and who their father is and all this other stuff. And Jesus says, no, your father is the devil. As a related aside, that is sometimes read as one of the more anti-Jewish things in this gospel. And so don't do that. And the other part of this is, I think, getting back to, again, what St. Paul is dealing with, which is that Abraham is the father of all believers. And again, in St. Paul, it's belief and works are, faith and works are linked. And how you spell that out, you know, is a matter for a different day. But basically, your faith inspires you to do good works, and your works sort of kind of prove that your faith exists. The thing here, which has been going on, is, remember, they're trying to kill Jesus. We will see this at the end when they actually do try to stone him, but they're trying to kill Jesus. And therefore the things that they're doing clearly are not following through from belief like Abraham had in God, and are following through from belief or following the devil and that sort of thing, which is pretty heavy language. But I think that's what's going on here. Any questions or comments on that? And I will load up my Zoom now on my other computer. Let's see if I can join you. Give me 1 second before we jump in.
Recording in progress.
We drop. Can you hear me?
Yes. Yes.
All right, hold on. See if I've got the right everything on. I do. Okay. I will open up the Bible, but Patrice, do you have a Bible in front of you?
Yes.
Can you read 48 to the end?
Yes.
And I will, by the time you're done, I'll have my online Bible up. But go for it.
The Jewish opposition answered, "We were right to say that you are a Samaritan and have a demon, weren't we?" "I don't have a demon," Jesus replied, "but I honor my father and you dishonor me. I'm not trying to bring glory to myself. There's one who is seeking to glorify me, and he's the judge. I assure you that whoever keeps my word will never die.
Keep going.
Oh, okay. That was the end of in my Bible. All right. Abraham and Jesus. The Jewish opposition said to Jesus, "Now we know that you have a demon. Abraham and the prophets died, yet you say, whoever keeps my word will never die. Are you greater than our father Abraham? He died and the prophets died. So who do you make yourself out to be?" Jesus answered, "If I glorify myself, my glory is meaningless. My father, who you say is your God, is the one who glorifies me. You don't know him, but I do. If I said I didn't know him, I would be like you, a liar. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father Abraham was overjoyed that he would see my day. He saw it and was happy." "You aren't even 50 years old," the Jewish opposition replied. "How can you say that you have seen Abraham?" "I assure you," Jesus replied, "before Abraham was, I am." So they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus hid himself and left the temple.
Okay, great. Can you see my screen now? Is it?
Yes.
Yes. So,
I'm going to focus on actually one thing that Patrice said, which was her translation is the Jewish opposition, yep. Right? So that gets into, and this whole passage is one of the more complicated in terms of reading it in terms of anti-Jewish material in John's gospel. That Patrice's translation is an out, which adds a qualifier, which is opposition, right? The text simply says the Jews answered him. And so what's going on in Patrice's answer is translation is the editors of that Bible. What Bible is it, Patrice?
It's the one that Mother Patty gave us, the Common English Bible.
Okay. The Common English, I have a copy of that too. So what's going on with that is they're adding, in this case and others, qualifiers for the modern audience. And there's nothing wrong with doing this. It's a qualifier that basically says, specifically, this is the Jewish opposition in Jesus's day and contains it in that. Whereas what the actual translation is the Jews. Now, the problem with the qualifier is that it fails to recognize, A, what the translation actually is, B, it also fails, I think, to deal with the reality that there was a different set of Jewish opposition in the evangelist's day, again, like 50 years later or so. So it qualifies it down to just one time and one place, whereas the evangelist would have probably been very much against all of the official Jews in his day. The problem with keeping it as just the Jews is that there's no qualifier whatsoever. And so people throughout history, and I'm sure even today, can go into this passage and say, oh, this is the Jews then, now, and forever, which is not good. It is a specific group at one time. And so I do like the translation, but it's not exactly what's in the text. So that's when you run into things like that. Sometimes it's a different way of translating it. Sometimes it's an adding an intentional qualifier to keep it in some time and some place. And the context here, or the passage itself, gets pretty nasty. I mean, he's already accused them of saying their father is the devil. Now they're saying he has a demon, and what have you. And that then he says that, what is it in verse 55? I would be a liar like you. You know the devil, you keep his word. So it's not a pleasant conversation that's going on here. And without the qualifier, this passage has been used to be anti-Jewish throughout history. And that's why the qualifier is there. And I think that's why the qualifier is probably helpful. But I also think sometimes it's not helpful. Any comments on that or any of this? Okay. One other thing. How old is Jesus? Anybody know?
He's 30, right?
30-ish, 33, early 30s. Well, in John, it never gets there. It says but in John, at least we know he's less than 50, right? So if you have an old Jesus in your passion pageant on Palm Sunday, I guess that Jesus needs to be at least under 50. So there you go. But all right, what else? If you remember how we started this passage, this whole chapter, it was about stoning. Do you remember the woman that was caught in adultery? And she is literally caught in the act of adultery, and they still refuse to stone her. In this case, they are trying to stone Jesus because of the conversation that they're having. And the end thing is a big sort of one of those I am moments in the gospel. And, you know, before Abraham was, I am. What is your translation on this, say, Patrice? I can't remember.
58?
Yeah.
I assure you, Jesus replied, before Abraham was, I am.
Okay. So what you have here is this double amen right here, very truly. Mm. Right. If we talked about that earlier. And the amen, and the tail end is the name of God. And this is one of the biggest ones in here. So it's an important moment in the gospel of Jesus identifying himself as God. And if nothing else, they get it. Right. They understand what he's talking about here and they don't like it. And so they're trying to stone him for blasphemy and for equating himself with God. And their logic behind that is that the only person that would do this is somebody who has a demon. He will say again and again, just watch the things that I've been doing. Do these things come from God or not? And the next chapter, which we will try to get all the way through right now, follows nicely on this, because we will see that this conversation in some way continues, but there's a discussion about can somebody who is not from God do these things?
Right. So if somebody walked into our church and started to say, I'm God, don't you know that I'm God? We'd be calling EMT and taking them away. We wouldn't pick up stones, but we would say, see you later, bye.
Correct. The difference here is that throughout this, if that person was going around raising people from the dead, and
we could see that, or we,
well, that's one of the, so the whole argument in John is the Jewish side gets mad at Jesus because he's equating himself with God, and the argument throughout is just watch what I'm doing and listen to what I'm actually saying and interpret the scriptures which testify to me and listen to John the Baptist. And it's that whole business of witnesses that plays and testifying that plays through the gospel is, and Nicodemus is one person that says this, other people do, can somebody who's not from God do these things? Mm-hmm. Right? So they refuse to listen to him on that. And he never overtly says, I am God. Actually, what he says, very truly, I tell you, before Abraham was, I am. You can translate this or understand this, Jesus is, I am God, or you can understand this as before Abraham was, God. God was there. Like, that's the name of God, give or take. But yes, if somebody came into church and started saying they were God, I would, or they were from God. I mean, that's the whole business of people being prophetic and this and that. Okay, so let's hear what you're actually saying and what are you actually doing? And that that runs into churches, clergy, church leaders, whole denominations run into problems. And you can think of myriad of these where the church says one thing, do what I tell you, but don't do what I do, right? And that runs into problems as well. Okay. Any other comments on 8?
I just have a comment, and it might sound simple, because most of the time Jesus is moving through the crowds, not really ducking, dodging. And it says he hid himself. So where did he hide himself? I mean, was there a building? Was there a tree? You know, very often he's in open, in open areas. So how did he hide himself when they were starting to stone him?
It's a good question. If we were doing a movie, and people have tried to do movies on the Jesus before and on John specifically, this is tricky to actually to do. He hit him. So what, does he run away? Does he jump?
Hide behind somebody?
Yeah. Well, so this is the sort of thing, this has happened before, and it actually happens in Luke's gospel too. They try to throw him off a cliff at one point. Mm-hmm. And he walks through the clouds and kind of the crowds and kind of disappears. Mm-hmm. So it's not narrated in a way that it's almost narrated in kind of a miraculous sense. There's a crowd there trying to stone him, and then suddenly
he's hidden. Yeah. Okay.
So the end result is they can't stone him and they can't get him. And this gets back into his hour has not yet come. That's not how he's going to die. He's going to die on the cross. He's going to be lifted up. And it's not the first time in John's gospel this has happened. And it's not the only time in the gospel narratives this happens. And it seems to be two things. One, I don't think Jesus is like Evel Knievel or whatever and trying, you know, an amazing escape, that sort of thing. I think the idea is that he, among his many gifts, is the ability to just kind of disappear and blend in or something like that. And he's just as, but the end result is they can't do what they want to do because his hour has not yet come. And I think when you're dealing with, I'm trying to remember what they did in the Gospel of John movie that came out 20 years ago. And I think the cameras kind of pan back and he kind of just moves off and then he's gone and they're looking around for him, which is not particularly satisfying. It's like, where'd he go? You know, or they, when they bend down to get the stones and come back up, it's like, he's gone, it's, you know, so, but I think that's the point. It's like, oh, wow, that's interesting that he did that. So, okay. Other final thoughts on this? Okay. Charlotte, you're unmuted. Can you read, let's see how far. Can you read the first chunk of this man born blind?
Okay. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me. While it is day, night is coming, when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, is this not the man who used to sit and beg? Some were saying, it is he. Others were saying, no, but it is someone like him. He kept saying, I am he. But they kept asking him, then how were your eyes open? He answered, the man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes and said to me, go to Siloam and wash. Then I went and washed and received my sight. They said to him, where is he? He said, I do not know.
Okay, great. We're going to keep reading, but a couple of things in here. Remember that we've had no real break from the Feast of Tabernacles, which was in chapter 7, all the way through in chapter 10, which we haven't gotten to, the Feast of Dedication. And the Feast of Dedication is essentially Hanukkah, and it's the rededication of the temple. And the theme of that feast and festival is light. And so some of the things that Jesus says here can be interpreted in that context. It's not clear for this chapter if he's there for dedication or if it's in between or if it's at Tabernacles. But when we get to chapter 10, it will say clearly that now it was the Feast of Dedication. The other things are, we've seen a lot of this before, night and day and that sort of thing. But there is a conversation around sin, which continues what we've had in the last chapter with the woman caught in adultery and Jesus and that sort of thing. And so the question here is, you know, is this guy blind because he sinned or his parents sinned? And Jesus gives a nice answer that no, it has nothing to do with that. He's been born blind only so God's works may be revealed in him, which does beg a different question. So this is, I think, answering a question in the time of, oh, if you have if you're blind or if you're deaf or if some accident has happened to you or if you've got some handicap or something, even something bad has happened to you. If you remember Job, like the whole book of Job is about this. What did you do to deserve this, right? And so Jesus is saying, no, nothing. You didn't do anything. Your parents didn't do anything. And then it opens the other question of, well, okay, if these things happen and you don't get better, well, why did this happen to this guy and not to me? And I think, again, in this context, it's simply so that Jesus can be revealed as God's agent in that time, in that place, through this man. Any comments or questions on the rest of this? Okay. Let's see who's up. James, I think yes. You read.
Let's see.
Read both 13, this whole chunk. Keep going. Yeah.
Okay. The Pharisees investigate the healing. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes. Then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." Others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It is your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked him, "Is this your son, who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that now he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age. Ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind, and they said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? He did not. How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "He is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us?" And they drove him out.
Okay, great. This is the heart of this entire story. So a couple of things get replayed here. They are willing in this case to not believe or unwilling to believe just the one person. So they bring in the family to witness on his behalf, right? That's the whole two witnesses thing being brought up again. And the whole conversation is first about, it's not what the man did. It's now what Jesus did. And their comparison is that he can't possibly be doing, be from, the whole conversation is about, is Jesus from God? Why? Because he doesn't observe the Sabbath, right? And so it's now judging between not observing the Sabbath and the customs and things like that, or more accurately, it's not observing the Sabbath, it's how one is appropriately observing the Sabbath, right? So it's following a particular interpretation of what it means to observe the Sabbath, which Jesus clearly is not doing to their satisfaction, versus doing these signs. And in this case, one of the signs is opening the eyes of a man who has born blind. The guy that is now able to see, and you'll probably recognize chunks from the hymn Amazing Grace from this, right? I once was born, but blind, but now I see. And he recognizes, and the man's journey of faith starts with, first, he's a prophet, that's Jesus, because they ask him. Second, he keeps going, and well, they don't believe him. And so they bring in his parents, and let's see. Then it's linked to anybody that confesses Jesus to be the Messiah has been put out of the synagogue. This is news, right? We haven't had this specifically stated at this point. And again, how much of this is in Jesus's time and how much of this is in the time, you know, 50 years later during St. John's community and that sort of thing. And the answer is definitely the latter and perhaps the former. It's hard to tell, but definitely the latter. And a lot of the animosity between St. John's community and the Jews could actually be linked to this right here, that they've been kicked out of the synagogues, right? Because there doesn't seem to be any evidence in the other gospel narratives that Jesus has been kicked out of the synagogues, and he's already been able to come in and go to the temple and that sort of thing. But it continues that really getting into where is Jesus from, where is Jesus not from? And the man, I think this is the crux of the entire thing, is this little passage. Here is an astonishing thing. You know, you do not know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. Patrice, that gets back into the, if the, somebody came into church and was like, I'm God, I'd be like, well, okay, let's test this out, which is its own problem, but, and I won't go down that road. But any comments on this passage?
What struck me is that they're all Jewish, and his parents said this is because they were afraid of the Jews.
Correct. Yeah.
So, which,
what did your translation say? I'd love to know what yours said.
22.
Yeah.
I'm like, what? They're all Jewish. What are they complaining about?
They are. Well, that's the whole thing. When people say John's gospel is anti-Jewish, the problem with that starts with the fact that they're all Jewish. So it's, yeah.
Okay, so 22 says, his parents said that this because they feared the Jewish authorities. Well, yep. That's a clear. This is because the Jewish authorities had already decided that whoever confessed Jesus to be the Christ would be expelled from the synagogue. That's why his parents said, he's old enough, ask him. Well, that makes sense. Jewish authorities now.
Yeah. So, well, that's why they put the qualifiers in, to make it clearer what's going on and to undermine the anti-Jewish arguments against the gospel and against this particular thing. But yes, they are all Jewish. His parents are all Jewish. So, you know, they were afraid of the Jews. The problem is his parents are part of that group too. So what does that mean? One way to think about it is not the Jewish authorities is one way to think about it. It can also be the mob, basically. You know, like the stirred up mob has decided that they're not, you know, willing to, not the mafia, but, you know, like the stirred up mob is has decided that anybody that confesses Jesus is going to get kicked out of the synagogue. And that's not that hard to envision. And there is divisions, not just among all of the Jews over who Jesus is, but even among the authorities. So the problem with the qualifier is that it doesn't get into what's actually in the text. And we see throughout, Nicodemus is an example of one of the Jewish authorities that doesn't line up with that. So there is still division there. Any other comments there? Anybody? Anybody? All right. How much do we have left? Ah, we will actually finish the chapter today. Patrice, can you finish the chapter?
Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me, so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." He said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees who were with him heard this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sinned. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains."
Okay. It's just the follow-up to it. I mean, it's the here you get at least the Pharisees and not the Jews as a whole. I think one thing in here is, if you remember earlier, the man born blind first didn't know who Jesus was, then confessed him as a prophet, then tried to bring in others to be his disciples. And now that Jesus identifies himself as the Son of Man, he says, "Oh, tell me who he is." So he believes Jesus, which is interesting, right? He believes fully in Jesus. "Tell me who he is so that I can believe in him." And he says, I'm him. And here he calls him, "Lord, I believe," and he worships him. And let's see what this little note says on sir. So in this case, this is one of those double plays in John. And it happens in other gospels too. The word Kyrie in Greek, which we used to use all the time, but Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy, right? Is Lord. It can also be master. It can be sir. It can be sort of a formal thing all the way up to, a formal thing for what you call a respectful title for any man, all the way up to what is in the Old Testament as the replacement for the actual name of God, the Lord, right? So this is probably best translated here, Lord. Patrice, what does yours translate it, verse 38, as? You're muted. Muted.
All right, hold on. 38. The man said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshiped Jesus.
Yeah. Okay. So they're doing the same thing there. The point of verse 38 is this guy has gone all the way from not knowing who Jesus is in one scene to believing him, calling him Lord, and worshiping him. So he's one of the few thus far, perhaps about the only one, that has made a complete journey of faith to the point where he recognizes exactly who Jesus is. Because at this point, nobody has worshiped Jesus. This is the first guy who worships Jesus, and this is a big deal. So he got it. In the last chapter, they were worried that Jesus was equating himself with God, and this guy falls in that line too, but this is what's correct. The second part is the issue around the Pharisees. It's people that claim to see and are wrong and claim to have all the knowledge and are wrong are the problem. And that's the issue here. Any comments or questions or anything?
I would just say this. To me, being blind is a big thing, even then and even now. So if somebody actually helps me to see, And even if I've gone through surgery or something like that, and I wake up, I can see, I'm happy. But the fact that somebody can do this and help me to see, I could understand that person being worshiped or, you know, truly thanked and for all time. So I just think that that's a big thing. And so I feel that the praise that's happening is, you know, I'd have to praise whoever it is that's going to help me see.
Well, I mean, that's sort of the point. It's like, and his point is nobody's ever done this. So clearly this guy is from God, full stop. That's his. Mm-hmm. Now, in modern science, where you go with that, they still haven't, you know, I read articles every now and then that are like, with AI, they can make us, you know, see. I'll be intrigued how that works. That's a slightly different thing. All right, we finished the chapter, which is good. Next week, we are on chapter 10, and it's the Good Shepherd stuff. So we will look at that next week. I apologize for the beginning, but with my computer issue, but it seemed to have worked out. So, all right, any final thoughts before we jump off? All right, God bless.
Thank you.
See you later. Bye-bye. Thank you for listening to Father Matt's Bible Studies and Sermons podcast. If you want to learn more, you can visit our website at christchurchpelham.org. christchurchpelham.org. God bless and have a great day.